It's half past eight.
It's half past eight New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Each week at this time, Lucky Strike presents Information Please. All you have to do is send us questions, hard ones. We think we have the boys who are tough enough to overcome them. For every question we use, Lucky Strike pays out $10 plus a copy of the new Information Please quiz book. If your question stumps us, you get $25 more plus a 24-volume set of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of duplication, Information Please uses the question that was received first, and all questions become the property of Information Please. And now, light up a Lucky as I introduce our master of ceremonies, the literary critic of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Ladies and gentlemen, uncabined, uncribbed, and unconfined, Information Please continues on its unrehearsed path. And strolling down the path tonight are the Samuel Pepys of our generation, the conductor of the Conning Tower in the New York Evening Post, Mr. Franklin P. Adams, and similarly the Macaulay of our generation, the sports authority, Mr. John Kieran. Our two guests are the eminent American novelist, Louis Bromfield, whose most recent book is Night in Bombay, and the distinguished motion picture star, who is no stranger to the air, Mr. Herbert Marshall. Now remember, for each question that's missed, Lucky Strike rings up $25. And that's paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Suppose we start this evening with a question coming to us from Jeff Davis of Audubon, New Jersey. He's apparently moved north. We have to get all on this. There are three parts. Name a prominent world statesman well known for the following costumes. The first one is well known for his hat. Which one would that be? Mr. Marshall.
Could conceivably be Winston Churchill.
I think it could be. What sort of hat does Mr. Churchill wear?
A variety of oddities.
Yes, but
no,
one at a time.
It's a cross between a derby bowler, as we call them in England, and a flat surface, not shiny, and a silk hat. That is roughly, it's of that sort of shape. It's compromised between the two.
Have you ever been a haberdasher, Mr. Marshall?
I have ambitions.
You we'll come talk to the utmost authority. That's exactly right, Mr. Marshall. Mr. Eden, perhaps, too, is known for his hat. It's a Homburg, I think, isn't it, Mr. Marshall?
Yes, but it's the same sort of thing that any of us would wear.
Same sort of thing,
the hat that Mr. Churchill wear.
Now, what prominent world statesman is well known for his uniforms? His uniforms, Mr. Bromfield.
Marshal Gering.
Marshal Gering, yes. I understand that he designs them himself.
One a day.
I wish we could keep him busy doing it. The third one is known for his cape. His cape. Who would that be? Mr. Kieran.
Lloyd George.
Well, I think Lloyd George, I have seen him in the movies with a cape around him, that's true. But I think even more particularly, another statesman or head of a state, or erstwhile head of a state, or erstwhile head of an erstwhile state. I can't keep this up forever, gentlemen. Mr. Kieran.
Haile Selassie.
Yes, Haile Selassie. The ex-emperor of Ethiopia. That
he has an umbrella, too.
I beg pardon?
He always has an umbrella, too.
He has an umbrella, too. That's quite right. If I'd said cape and umbrella, I think it would have been too easy, Mr. Bromfield. That gives us 3 out of 3. Jane Barry of Colorado Springs sends this one in. Get 2 out of 3, gentlemen, if you can. I'm going to name some sums of money. Up, Mr. Adams. Yeah, there's a look of interest in the eye. In what books, plays, or movies do these sums of money figure prominently? The first sum is 3,000 ducats. Mr. Marshall.
The Merchant of Venice?
In The Merchant of Venice, yes. And how is the sum used in the book? What part is played?
The Merchant of Venice is... Antonio is indebted to the Merchant of Venice. The Merchant of Venice is Antonio. I'm sorry.
That's
He's
right.
indebted to the Jewish...
Yes, to Shylock.
Shylock.
Exactly right, Mr. Marshall. Very good. That disposes of 3,000 ducats. Now, how about $300? $300. That is really hard. If I say $300 to be used for paying the taxes, would that make it any easier? $300 to pay the taxes.
Blank.
A blank. I draw a blank on that. Some of you who may have seen the picture, and some of you may have read the book, a well-known book in its day, Gone with the Wind, will remember that Scarlett needs the money, $300, in order to pay the back taxes on the famous family estate of Tara. Draw a blank on that, Mr. Adams?
Plank on that.
I'm sorry, that gives us one wrong. Now I have to get the next one right. $10,452. $10,452.
In what book, play, or movie does that exact sum play a considerable part? Well, I'm very sorry. I'm very sorry to see, Mr. Marshall, that unlike most Englishmen, you forget your debts. In the letter in which I believe you played a very prominent part.
It was 10,000, though, wasn't it?
It was 10,452, of which you had to pay 10,000, did you not, to get possession of the letter?
I think they must have been shooting that scene about the 452 when I wasn't there
when
one
you
day.
Weren't there. Well, do you have a stand-in for $452?
And?
10,452, Mr. Marshall had saved up in the letter, and 10,000 had to be paid out for it, leaving $452 sheer profit, Mr. Marshall.
Mm-hmm.
That gives us two wrong and sends $25 in a set of the Britannica to Miss Barry, courtesy of Lucky Strike, and sends us on to the next question from James Nelbud of Brooklyn. Get 2 out of 3 on this. This is a sound effects question, gentlemen. You're going to hear several signals, one after the other, as is our custom. There are 3 of them. What sport would you be witnessing if you heard them? Let's have the first. What sport? Mr. Kieran?
Racing.
Yes, horse racing. No question about
Jockey's
that.
Jockey's up, I guess.
How vivid do you make it all, Mr. Kieran? Mr. Marshall, you weren't going to give us any alternative answer,
no,
were you?
No,
that's
no.
Right. Now the next. Let's have the next. Oh, I have 3 hands. Mr. Marshall?
Fox hunting.
Fox hunting. No question about that. Mr. Adams, you were going to say fox hunting.
I was going to say fox hunting at Tantivy.
And someday I'd like to see you in a pink coat, Mr. Adams, if you don't mind. It's a date. Been wearing the same pink tie now for 4.5 years. It's about time you enlarged your costume. Now the third of these signals. Mr. Kieran.
Hockey. Ice hockey.
Yes, end of a hockey period. Is there any other sport, Mr. Kieran, in which you might be apt to hear that signal?
No,
it sounds very much like a dental drill.
That I know by ear.
not in the fights, in boxing?
They have a buzzer to sound a 10-second warning before a round starts. That's something like that.
Something like that. I guess either of those answers would be quite correct. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. Thank you very much, gentlemen. And now back to literature and to Mr. Kieran's favorite author, W. Shakespeare. Jenny Davis of Yorkville, Ohio, sends this one in. We're glad to get a question from Ohio, which is Mr. Bromfield's state, native state. Quote 3 speeches from 3 different characters of Shakespeare, characters who had the blues. In other words, any melancholy speeches or pessimistic ones. Mr. Marshall, suppose you start us off.
Antonio's, the opening of Merchant of Venice, Antonio's speech, in sooth, I know not why I am so sad. It wearies me, you say it wearies you. I think I'm accurate.
That's very good, yes. You couldn't go on with that, could you, Mr. Marshall?
I wouldn't care to.
That's very good. Now, Mr. Adams.
'Tis bitter cold, and I am sick at heart.
Who says that?
Somebody says that in the first act of Hamlet.
Is that right, Mr. Kieran?
Yes, that's right.
That's right.
For this relief, much thanks.
That's good enough. Yes, sir. That's a semi-pessimistic statement. Mr. Kieran?
Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow drags in this petty pace from day to day, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death.
Take him away, he's breaking my heart.
Who said those melancholy words, Mr.
Macbeth.
Kieran?
Macbeth.
Macbeth, yes. Mr. Bromfield, you had one at the tip of your tongue?
Most obvious of all, to be or not to be.
Yes, that's a very good one, and we all should have thought of that, to be or not to be.
Shakespeare's full of them.
In Hamlet, Shakespeare is full of them. And yet he had his gayer moments, too, no doubt.
They weren't as good.
You don't think so? The next question comes from Elaine S. Kramer of Baltimore. Get all on this. It seems to me a rather easy question. Which of the following people of fact or fiction are related to each other? I'm going to give you a set of people. Some are related, and perhaps some are not. Now, the first is the Pepper family. Ben, Polly, Claude, and Phronsie. Which are related and which are not? Ben, Polly, Claude, and Phronsie of the Pepper family. Mr. Adams.
I think they're all related.
You think they're all related?
I think they're 5 little Peppers.
Yes, but I named only 4. There are 5 little Peppers. That's perfectly true. But not all of that group are related.
I think they're related. I never read it, never got any further than the title.
You want me to tell you? Ben, Polly, and Phronsie, ladies and gentlemen, and kiddies for that matter, are related. But Claude is the
senator
from Florida, Mr. Claude Pepper. Yes.
That's a very good question.
I think we should have known that. I think we should have known that Claude is the senator from Florida, and not a member of the famous Pepper family of the novel. Now, how about the next one? That's one wrong. The Bennett family. Barbara, Elizabeth, Lydia, and Jane. Some related, perhaps some not. Mr. Romfield.
Barbara's not.
Barbara is not. That's quite Barbara right. Now, who are the others?
The other three are Pride and Prejudice. The other three are Pride and Prejudice.
Yes. There are three of the characters in Pride and Prejudice. And who is Barbara Bennett?
Barbara's I don't like to say the sister of Connie and Joan. I'll say the daughter of Dick Bennett.
That's a very nice way of putting it. Yes, a member of the famous acting Bennetts. Yep. That gives us one right. Now, how about the Adams family? As follows: Henry, Abigail, Alice, and John. Which are related, which are not. Mr. Bromfield again.
Alice Adams is not related.
Who is Alice Adams?
She's the heroine of a Booth Tarkington novel.
Yes, quite right. And all the others are
Adams family.
Members of the very famous Adams family that gave us two presidents. Now, how about, finally, the Sanger family? Kate, Margaret, Teresa, and Antonia. Sanger. Mr. Marshall.
Teresa and Antonia are related, are they not?
Teresa and Antonia are related. I have two more for you. Kate and Margaret. Mr. Adams.
Margaret Sanger is not one of the fiction girls.
That's right.
She had been. There wouldn't be so many.
Yes, Mr. Rockwell. That's very probably true.
Well said.
And, Mr. Adams, when you say fiction girls, you're referring to what work of fiction?
The Constant Nymph.
The Constant Nymph, yes. All except Margaret, who is famous for her work in Birth Control, are in The Constant Nymph. Well, I'm afraid that sends $25 instead of the Britannica to Miss Kramer of Baltimore. Thank you very much. Now, how about this question from Alberta R. Klein of Easton, Pennsylvania? This is rather tricky, gentlemen. Will you attend carefully? How many lenses in all would an Olympian optician have to grind in order to provide spectacles for Polyphemus, the Grii, and Argus all together? Polyphemus, the Grii. Grii is spelled G-R-A-E-A-E. That's all the A-E's I'm going to give you this evening. And Argus. How many spectacles, how many lenses, rather, in all, would he have to grind? You have the sum with the Mr. Adams.
Is this collaboration?
No. The collaboration is the thief of time. We must have it just from one man. A guess, gentlemen.
Two out of three?
No, you have to give me a sum, Mr. Adams.
Four.
Mr. Kieran?
About 600.
How do you make it out?
Well, they had about 100 eyes apiece, and there were three sets of them. That makes 600.
No, that wouldn't be true. You're too generous with your eyes this evening, Mr. Kieran. Mr. Bromfield.
Didn't Polyphemus have three eyes?
No.
Argus, one.
Polyphemus had how many eyes?
One.
He had one eye.
Oh,
yes, that means one lens so far. Now, who was Argus?
He had 100. Argus,
he had 100, yes.
Argus,
that gives us 101. And who is or are the Grii? Here's where you get into trouble.
Sticks me.
The Grii were three dreadful sisters in Greek mythology. I don't know what their given names were, but they were known as the Horrifier, the Shaker, and the Terrifier, respectively. And these three sisters had one eye and one tooth in common. Now, they used to sort of exchange them, you see, an eye for a tooth and a tooth for an eye. And they had only one eye altogether. That gives us how many lenses, gentlemen?
204.
102, John. You can't even listen.
Somebody certainly gets an encyclopedia on that one.
I think that Miss Klein gets an Encyclopedia Britannica and $25, and a lucky strike for her. Now, let us see. We have lost to date $75 and three sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, Mr. Cross twists an old saying, somewhat brutally perhaps, but for good purpose, to come up with this.
In speaking of cigarettes, handsome is as handsome buys. No cigarette is better than the tobacco that's bought for it at the auctions. That's why Lucky Strike, at auction after auction, consistently pays higher prices to get the finer, lighter, naturally milder tobaccos. For instance, here are the latest reports for this season from the Big Burley Tobacco Market at Knoxville, Tennessee. The American Tobacco Company has paid 28% more per pound for the tobacco we bought for our cigarettes and other tobacco products. Yes, 28% above the average market price paid for all the various types and grades of tobacco sold there. And the best we bought will go to Lucky's. Well, in buying tobacco, you get what you pay for. The independent tobacco experts know that well, so they smoke Lucky's 2-to-1. Why not profit by precept and example? For a cigarette of finer, lighter, naturally milder tobaccos, ask for Lucky Strike.
Handsomely spoken, Mr. Cross, in just 58 seconds. And perhaps this is as good a time as any to wish all our listeners a very Merry Christmas, and also to announce that Information Please has just a few minutes ago received its own Christmas present in the form of a telegram, which we've just received from Mr. Jack Ellicott, the publisher of the Radio Daily. Now, on Monday, Mr. Ellicott tells us, Radio Daily will announce the result of a nationwide poll of newspaper and magazine radio editors and writers. And he says the critics again pick Information Please as their favorite quiz show. Congratulations. Well, we're very glad to get that Christmas present, and we hope we'll get the same one next year. And now shall we go on with the second half of the program with a question coming to us from Gerda Jensen of Racine, Wisconsin. Name three plays, gentlemen, in which a measure of time is mentioned in the title. Any day, hour, minute, whatever you choose. Mr. Adams.
Once in a lifetime.
That got them all in, yes. Once in a lifetime. Very good. A lifetime is a measure of time. How about another? Mr. Adams again.
I think there's one called Days Without End. Mm-hmm.
I think it's the title of a novel. No, I'm not positive of that. I'd rather get two more that I'm sure of. Mr. Kieran?
Twelfth Night.
Twelfth Night. Very good. That gives us a night and a lifetime. Sometimes very similar. Mr. Kieran?
The Winter's Tale.
A Winter's Tale, yes. A winter is a measure of time, yes. How about one with the word hour in it? Oh, there was a very famous play that ran. Mr. Marshall?
The Night Must Fall.
The Witching Hour.
The Night Must Fall, very good.
The Witching Hour.
The Witching Hour by Augustus Thomas. The Children's Hour by Lillian Hellman. Mr. Kieran?
The Midnight Bell.
Midnight Bell, yes. How about the Second Mrs. Tanqueray? Is that all right, Mr. Adams? Second Mrs. Tanqueray, very good.
The 61st Second.
Yes, that would be a very good one. Or Morning Becomes Electra. How about that? That captures the climax and sends us on to a question from Miss Rosalind Bauman of Brooklyn. Here's a rather timely question. We are all very much interested in the makeup of our army at the moment. Name the army unit which is normally under the command of the following officers. Get 3 out of 4 if you can on this. What army unit is commanded by a colonel? Mr. Kieran.
A regiment.
A regiment, correct. By a first lieutenant. Mr. Marshall.
Company?
No. No, not a company. Mr. Kieran?
Generally, the first platoon.
Yes, a platoon. That's right.
First platoon.
What is the what other kinds are there?
Well, second lieutenant, of which there are more, drop back to the third, fourth, and fifth platoon.
I see. How about a major general? A major general commands what? Mr. Kieran again.
A division.
A division. And finally, a captain commands what unit of the army? Mr. Kieran again.
A company.
A company. Well, that gives us 3 out of 4 and sends us on to a question from Mr. L. Lapidus of Brooklyn. Who was the nemesis or jinx of each of these people, of fact or fiction? Get 3 out of 4 if you can. Who is the jinx of Madame Defarge? That's from The Tale of Two Cities, as you remember, and Mr. Kieran obviously remembers.
Miss Pross.
Miss Pross, yes. What sort of character was she?
She was the guardian, the nurse of Lucy Manette, and she just dogged that other knitting woman to her, her dying day.
Yes, she was too much for Madame Defarge. And how about Dillinger? Who was Dillinger's jinx? Mr. Brumfield.
I don't remember her name. She had a red dress.
Well, I think you must know more about Mr. Dillinger than we do.
Well, I could tell you about... she pointed him out. She was arrested. She was finally... received the reward, and she was finally deported. And she had a Polish name, I think. And that's the
problem. That is true. That wasn't what I had in mind. I mean the person who actually was responsible for the arrest or capture of Dillinger. Any of you remember?
Some G-man.
Yes. But what was his name? Mr. Adams, remember?
No.
Do you, Mr. Kieran?
Well, Mr. Hoover's the only one I know.
It wasn't Mr. Hoover, no. It was Melvin H. Purvis, P-U-R-V-I-S. And I think that's what I meant, Mr. Bromfield, though...
I think the woman was more a nemesis than the...
Well, that, I'll accept the woman willingly. Now, how about Hotspur. Who was Hotspur's nemesis? Mr. Kieran.
Why, his nemesis was... Prince Hal.
Prince Hal, yes. In what play would you find that out?
Henry IV, Part 2.
Part 2, very good. How about Babe Ruth? His jinx was who? Mr. Kieran again.
He was a left-handed pitcher who is now a dentist, and his name was...
A left-handed dentist is a very dangerous thing to be.
Oh, I know his name very well, but it just doesn't come to mind.
I don't think that I'm going to dock you for not giving us the name. A left-handed pitcher for...
Wait a minute, from St. Louis.
From St. Louis.
Okay, and pitched afterwards for the Giants for a short time. Just give me his first name or...
I'll give you Doc.
Pruitt.
Doc Pruitt. Thank you very much, Mr. Kerr. How was it, Mr. Kieran, that Babe Ruth was always struck out by him? Is there any...
No, he just had a jinx arm and a very wide left-handed curve, and he struck out the Babe 11 times out of 13 that he faced him, which was extraordinary.
It certainly sounds extraordinary to me. And is it really true that he's become a left-handed dentist since those days?
Yes. He works from the left side and yanks out only teeth on the right side of him.
I suppose he only sends you half of a bill at the end of the month. Mrs. W.H. Harrison of New Rochelle sends this one in. Get 3 out of 4. This is a very timely question about Christmas. What's the equivalent of our American Santa Claus in these countries? In England, you call Santa Claus what? Mr. Marshall.
Father Christmas.
Father Christmas, yes. And in France, Mr. Kieran.
Père Noël.
Père Noël. And in Germany? In Germany, gentlemen.
Reluctance?
I don't know, unless it's been in the papers.
I don't think so. Mr. Bromfield?
It's St. Nicholas. It's in Holland or in Germany.
How about...
That's where he comes by Santa Claus.
That's quite right.
St. Nicholas.
Which of those two countries, Holland or Germany?
I think they both call him St. Nicholas.
No, in Holland he's called Kris Kringle.
Kris Kringle.
And in... I beg your pardon, in Germany he's called Kris Kringle, and in Holland he's called, Mr. Bromfield?
St. Nicholas.
St. Nicholas. And as you say, Santa Claus is a corruption of St. Nicholas or San Nicolas. Well, that gives us 3 out of 4. Peter C. Allen of Palo Alto, California, sends this one in. Get 2 out of 3, if you can. As you know, a great many modern plays derive their titles from lines from Shakespeare. They derive their plots in many cases, too. I'm going to ask you to quote the lines and name the plays from which the following derived their titles. The first is Dear Brutus. Where does the phrase Dear Brutus come from? Mr. Marshall.
The play Julius Caesar?
Oh. That's quite right. And can you give us the lines? In your very best voice, Mr. Marshall. There isn't any other, I know.
I'll turn it over to Mr. Adams, please.
Mr. Adams?
It's something like the fault is not in ourselves, dear Brutus, that we are underlings. Something like that.
Yes, you got everything right with the syntax, Mr. Adams. It's very good. Mr. Kieran, want to straighten us out just a bit?
Fault is not in our stars, 'tis in ourselves that we are thus or so.
But in ourselves that we are underlings. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. From Julius Caesar, who says the words? Does any of you remember, Mr. Kieran?
I think it is Cassius.
Cassius is quite right. Now, how about the play Rain from Heaven? It derives its title from famous line or lines? Mr. Bromfield.
The quality of mercy is not strained. It falleth, droppeth or falleth like a gentle rain.
Droppeth as a gentle rain.
On the earth below, etc. Et
That's right. Thank you, Mr. Marshall and Mr. Bromfield. That's from what play?
Merchant of Venice.
Merchant of Venice. Now, how about...
Portia says it.
Finally, that's right. Portia says it, a famous speech about mercy. Now, how about the play, The Play's the Thing? The Play's the Thing. Mr. Bromfield?
No, I was thinking another one.
Mr.
All the world's a stage.
The play's the thing in which we'll catch the conscience of the king from Hamlet.
Good enough. Mm. There was one tiny error in the quotation, Mr. Kieran. Would you like to know what it is?
Yes.
The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
It's spoken by one of the players.
Is it spoken by Hamlet
spoken
or
spoken by Hamlet.
I thought it was spoken by Hamlet. Now
Yes, that's right.
I think it is spoken by Hamlet.
That's
part of the plot.
Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. You're very good at this, gentlemen. Now, here's a much lighter question from Gene Campbell of Newcastle, Pennsylvania. Give me 4 quotations, prose, poetry, anything you wish, about footwear. About footwear. Mr. Adams.
All God's children got shoes.
Good enough. That's very good. That gives us 1. Now, you can take any part of a shoe or a boot, Mr. Marshall.
Boots, marching on, was that Kipling, was it?
Yes. That's very good. Is that 2 quotations or just 1 set of boots that you're giving us? Boots? That gives us 2. Now, how about Mr. Bromfield?
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had many children.
Very good, yes. That gives us 3. Mr. Adams?
Thomas Paine. These are the times that try men's souls.
That's a perfect one. Any others? There are shoes and ships and sealing wax, of course, from Lewis Carroll, and probably we could think of many others. Ellen Schreiter of this city sends this one in. What is the official title of the present head of the government of each of the following countries? Get 3 out of 4 on this one. What is the official title of the head of Hungary? Mr. Bromfield.
He's a dictator. His title is Admiral.
No, that's one of his titles, but his Admiral official Horthy. Title as... Mr. Kieran?
Regent.
Regent, yes. Regent. It's Admiral Horthy.
Yeah.
That's right. Now, how about Egypt? What is his official title? Mr. Marshall, was your hand up?
Khedive?
No, it used to be, I guess.
That's right,
it used to be. Mr. Bromfield?
King, now.
King, yes. Right. And the present king is?
King Fuad.
I think it's Farouk.
Farouk. I think it's Arabia. I got the
yes, King Farouk. And France. The present head of France is called what? Mr. Bromfield?
Well, isn't he called the premier of France?
No, no. I think you're thinking of France of a little time ago.
No, because, well, the only reason I say that is because Laval's title, I know, was vice premier.
That's right. But the head, the actual head of the government, is known as the chief of state.
Chief of, yes, that's well, right.
The chief of state.
Yeah.
And who is the chief of state, gentlemen?
Petain,
Mr. Kieran, thank you very much. And how about Turkey? What is the title of the head of Turkey? Well, it's one that we all ought to know.
Not the Pasha.
No, not the Pasha. It's president. President. Just exactly like our own. President Ismet Inonu. Well, I think that sends $25 instead of the Britannica to Miss Shrita. And Mrs. F. Frauenfeld sends this one in of this city. To what books or plays would you go to find these Christmas gifts? A turkey. Mr. Adams.
I don't like to say what play, but any bad play.
That's a good answer. Wasn't what I was thinking of, though, Mr. Brownfield.
Something that closes Saturday night.
Christmas Carol. Dick.
Christmas Carol, yes. A trip to Paris. As a Christmas present you'd find in?
Sentimental Journey.
No, I don't remember it. I was thinking of Somerset Maugham's Christmas Holiday. And you'd find four penguins as a Christmas present where? Four present. You'd find it in The Man Who Came to Dinner. Well, that sends $25 instead of the Britannica to Mr. Frauenfeld. And now, Mr. Cross, we have, let me see, Mr. Cross is famous for bringing us the facts about cigarettes, and he's going to tell us about a group of people who already know those facts from A to Z.
They're the tobacco experts, Mr. Fadiman, and they don't need to be told anything about any cigarette, for they already know just what tobacco the different cigarette companies buy. They see the grades and the prices paid. And their good common sense reasoning about cigarettes can be summed up in just these five words. It's the tobacco that counts. So it certainly means a lot that the overwhelming majority of independent tobacco experts, the ones not connected with any cigarette company, choose Lucky's for their own smoking enjoyment. Sworn records show that over twice as many of these independent buyers, auctioneers, and warehousemen smoke Lucky's exclusively as smoke all other cigarettes combined. Remember that next time you buy cigarettes. Remember, it's the tobacco that counts, and independent tobacco experts see Lucky's pay the price to get the finer, lighter, naturally milder tobacco.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. Our losses are $100 and four sets of the Britannica. Thank you, Mr. Bromfield. Thank you, Mr. Marshall, for coming down tonight. Next week, Mr. Levant, Mr. Kieran, and Mr. Adams will be aided by the noted American novelist and short story writer, Mr. Walter D. Edmonds. Now, remember, for every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $10. If the question stumps our experts, you not only get $25 more, but in addition, the complete 24-volume set of the Britannica. Send your letters with questions and correct answers to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs, famous tobacco auctioneer of Goldsboro, North Carolina.
And that chant, fully interpreted, ladies and gentlemen, means Lucky's pay higher prices for the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobaccos. With independent tobacco experts, auctioneers, buyers, warehousemen, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.